Hello and welcome to Coping with COVID. I'm your host, Brian Mulligan. On this program, we'll help tell the stories and share the successes of people and organizations as we all deal with this COVID-19 pandemic. Our focus is on keeping people safe and re-energizing the economy, not doing one or the other, but trying to do both. Our guest today is Kelly Boatright, President and CEO of the Greater North Fulton Chamber of Commerce, of which Applied Information is a proud member. Kelly, welcome to Coping with COVID.
Thank you, Brian. Thanks for the invitation. I'm happy to be with you.
So talk to us a little bit about the chamber and how you constituted and your makeup and mission before we get on to the specifics of how you're dealing with COVID.
Absolutely. Well, the Chamber of Commerce in Greater North Fulton is the only regional chamber in North Fulton. We actually work with six cities. Those cities include Sandy Springs, Alpharetta, Roswell, Johns Creek, Milton, and Mountain Park. And so in doing so, really our mission or our focus is in being the regional leader for business growth and for regional prosperity, as well as talent development, which, as we all know, before COVID was a big area of concern. Before COVID, gosh, we had fewer people than we needed for the jobs that were available, and now we've kind of flipped that. So still looking at the talent development model, but really trying to get people back employed to your economic recovery point.
Okay, so let's talk about the COVID thing in two sections. One is what the chamber is doing. Have you guys managed to stay safe and continue to function in the pandemic?
We have, thank you, yes. So we have a team of 10 individuals who work for the chamber and who, since the occurrence of COVID, and certainly in Georgia, we were actually, as a chamber, hosting our state conference here in Alpharetta when the governor came online to let us know that the first death had been in Georgia. And so on that Friday, which was March 13th, we kind of gathered together and created a plan of action for something that no one had a map or any background or history in. And immediately the next week went to work from 10 different locations from our homes. Luckily, we were set up to do that. And so we immediately began calling our members to check in with them, knowing intuitively that they would be as much at a loss as we were when this all occurred. And certainly our small businesses, we found that to be the case. So reaching out individually to those businesses and then quickly pivoting, which is our new word, right, to be able to offer webinars and items on Zoom, which was our preferred method of communication. And since that time, we have done more than 100 webinars and occurrences or events on Zoom and virtually. And so since that time, we really have been focused on making sure that we're meeting our members where they are. We have some that are ready to come back, and we are doing some in-person events, but certainly many of them are still caught up in the virtual piece, and so we're continuing to do that. We came back to the office on May 4th and have been in the office since. Luckily, with no occurrences for staff, we've been healthy. And so, like you, we're focusing on making sure that we're wearing our masks and taking temperatures and staying 6 feet apart and following all the guidelines to be able to keep our people safe. Because it's, you know, I like your focus. It's important. We're worried about the health of our region, but also wanting to make sure that that economic impact is minimized and that the recovery is really coming about.
Something that we're all finding in the private sector is this business of potentially we're never going to go back to like it was. What's your sense in the chamber about virtual meetings versus in-person meetings? And you know, there were 100% in-person before, and right, then went to 100%. Do you think it's going to be 50-50? How do you see it settling out?
Gosh, my magic ball is on the fritz, so I wish I could answer that. Honestly, I think that everybody's so focused on the new normal, and I would tell you that with as much innovation that I've seen in the last 6 months, I don't know that there is going to be a new normal. I think what we're going to see is a continuing innovation. You know, right now, I would tell you that, again, meeting our members where they are is incredibly important. So I believe we are going to have a blend of both virtual and in-person, so a hybrid of some sort. I know that I was on a 7:30 a.m. Zoom meeting this morning, and I will tell you that is a whole lot easier than getting up, getting dressed, and getting out the door to make a 7:30 in person. So I think some of those are going to really stay in that virtual means, plus more people are able to participate. But I do believe we did a business after hours. Chambers are the great connectors. And we had, of course, we're limited by 50 right now, but we've done two in-person business after hours now, and both of those have sold out. In other words, people are signing up in numbers that, you know, we've got waiting lists and people are ready to get back. So for us, I think it's gonna look like a hybrid.
Okay, so moving over to your members, how they've faced, obviously it's been devastating for people in the restaurant and you know, personal services industries and
Certainly. Things.
But across the mix of businesses that you represent, where would you characterize that folks are up to? Desperate, coming back, optimistic, not yet, where we're in the spectrum?
Well, that one I can answer because we have been surveying our members. So
Chamber
itself has 1,200 members, and they range from micro businesses, people who are working from their homes as a one-person business, if you will, to very large multinational corporations. And so with that kind of diversity of business, you're going to, of course, see a lot of differences in where people are. For our large businesses, a number of them that are multinational, of course, have got to really be making decisions across the board. And so we're hearing from a lot of those that they will not be physically back in the office until after the first of the year. So we know that that's the case, and we know that some of them are prevented from showing up to events or activities where there are other people. You also have businesses, especially in that small and medium size, who are, you know, the number one thing for all of us is protecting our people. And so in order to do that, they are maybe coming back, but coming back at 50%. I haven't talked to anybody who has, aside from those obviously who unfortunately have not weathered the storm, so to speak, and have not, their businesses have not survived, but I've not talked to anybody who is not still doing business in some form or fashion, whether that be remotely or in the office at a reduced number of employees, which takes us to the furloughs and layoffs that we're seeing. But we've done three separate surveys of our membership.
I'm interested in the surveys.
Yeah.
Really, give us the high level, what did you guys discover?
So I want to give credit where credit's due. The survey idea actually came from Andrea Worthy, who is our economic development director in Sandy Springs. And so what we did was collaborate, which chambers are also really good at. And so working with all six of our city economic development directors, as well as Select Fulton, the county, and numerous others from Georgia Power and Department of Labor, we created a survey that we started in June. And so asking the questions that you were asking, you know, where are you on the spectrum? Are you back? Where are you on a number of employees? Are you laying off or furloughing? And so in asking all those questions, we got a lot of response in June. We've done it a month apart. So we did the survey again in July and then again in August.
Okay.
Yeah, and so the responses that we're hearing are actually fairly consistent. The things that our members are most concerned about really fall into, of course, cash flow and liquidity, which everybody's concerned about right now. What's going to happen? How long is this going to last? And will I have the cash flow to weather that storm? As well as the consumer confidence area. So you and I both know that until the consumer feels confident to go back out and do business, that's the biggest concern. We want to make sure our consumers are coming out and doing business with us. We know that lots of people have flexed to do online business. We see that in the numbers that we see coming down. But we want to make sure those consumers are confident. So that's the second area of concern. Along with that, how do you market to those consumers, right? Because they're different now. They're in different places. The third area, which probably isn't a big surprise to you, is really that child care element. So what do I do if my child is not in school or if there's no place to send them for child care? And so that's really the three areas that we've heard repeated through all three of the surveys.
Is your sense that those issues are improving, or from June, July, and August, are we still in the trough of this not knowing what to do?
I think they are improving. The numbers have changed, and I think you can also see that sort of in an intuitive basis by the number of people who've replied to those surveys. When we started the survey in June, everybody wanted to tell us about it and talk, and now as people are getting back into the swing of business, and you know, for all of us, you know, 50 Zoom calls a day, what we're seeing is that less people are responding. And I don't think necessarily that's a bad thing. I think that folks are really back into the swing of things and are finding themselves with less discretionary time to be able to do things like that. But the answers remain the same.
Okay, so how would you say COVID's changed the economy and the job market? And again, I don't want to put you on the spot in your crystal ball, but maybe, you know, anything that you've heard from your members, if we had this interview, let's say 12 months from now.
Right.
What do you think we'll be talking about?
Well, and I'm very glad you asked me 12 months from now, because in response to the surveys that we've done, we've put together what we call an economic recovery task force. And really it's dealing with the things that we're hearing from our members in our phone calls, but also from our members in the surveys that we've put out there. There are five different areas to the survey, and so those areas really encompass the work of individuals, volunteers, who we have tapped and who have volunteered to work in each of these task force groups. Those task force groups we know will go to 12 to 18 months. So, you know, we had a strategic plan as a chamber, as all good chambers do. We kind of put it back on the shelf, and this is our new strategic plan. So I'd love to tell you about those areas just because I think they resonate with what you're hearing as well. So the first is, of course, cash flow and liquidity, which I mentioned is a huge area. And so, as we know, we're waiting at this time to find out if there's going to be a fourth round of PPP. We don't know what's going to happen, but that is certainly an area of concern for our members, and so it is for us as well. The second area is on sort of that government public policy and liability issue. We know that there are going to be numerous lawsuits. There's a lot of concern about that. Certainly our schools, our healthcare industry is worried about that as well. And so it's really focusing on how we can work along with government and be a good ombudsman for our members to be able to navigate that. The third area is that workforce unemployment area that we were talking about. You know, Georgia is now at 7.6% unemployment, which looks vastly different than March's 2.5%.
Right.
So it looks and it feels different. And so we are working, again, collaborating with our partners on how we can be part of the solution to make sure that our businesses get great employees and that our residents get employed. So it's really two ends of the same discussion.
Would you say that the employment has turned, or?
So we own a job search website, which I would recommend everybody going to. That's northfultonjobs.com. And on that site, we've got right now about 150 jobs posted. So I would tell you that there are jobs available.
Okay.
I also want to be very real and say that, you know, when you read the news in the morning, you see that there are additional companies that are doing layoffs because of the cash flow and liquidity issue, right? They've weathered the storm as long as they can. They have to move from furlough to layoff. We empathize with that. We certainly want to make sure that we're helping the business survive, because that's important, but also want to make sure those employees who are being displaced, we're offering a good service to. So again, northfultonjobs.com is part of that workforce unemployment, which is the third task force. The fourth task force is small business and entrepreneurism. You're an entrepreneur. You know that times like this bring out the best entrepreneurs, right?
Oh, yeah.
Those folks who've kind of been waiting around for that right opportunity, for some of them, this is it. And so we want to be creating sort of those mentors and the ecosystem to support those entrepreneurs as they step out and sort of test the waters, many for the first time. So that's important.
In fact, on the entrepreneurs side, there's the saying where when others are bold, be fearful, but when others are fearful, be bold.
That's right.
And so this is the time to start your new business. You can get great staff, great support in times of trouble. So that's when we started Applied Information in this business, is in the big recession.
Yes, and we know that, and you see that based on data. So we want to make sure that we're providing support and able to, if people are contacting us and saying, I have this idea, that we've got somewhere to go, and we've got somewhere to send them. Because we, you know, entrepreneurs are the future of the country. That's where every great idea, you know, every great business started with an idea. Right. And so we want to be part of that. The fifth area is somewhat self-serving. It's about what the chamber might look like at the end of this. We're a business like every other business. We're a nonprofit. As a 501c6 membership nonprofit, you know, it's important to us that we understand that we're not going to look the same. Chambers can't look the same at the end of this any more than our businesses can. And so really wanting to do the best for our members means understanding what is best when we come out, and whatever that looks like. I don't like to use the new normal phrase only because I really believe we're evolving.
Kelly, that was fantastic. Thanks so much for being our guest and very helpful and informative. What I do sometimes with the end of these coping with COVID is just talk a little bit about the data. And so what I have here is something that's, you know, particular to the times that we're in, and the latest, some of the latest discussion goes around the business of herd immunity, and should we, you know, actually not worry about the mask wearing and stuff, and let everybody get infected. Before we, you know, there's some data around that, and this graph, which I got this morning, shows the situation. There's a case study in the Nordic countries, which is Sweden, Denmark, Finland, and Norway, and where, you know, they're very much the same demographics, and so a lot of factors are controlled. But what you see is that Sweden decided not to do social distancing, not to do some of the restrictions on sporting events and large gatherings, whereas Denmark, Finland, and Norway did. And what you see is something quite interesting, which is this graph that you see at the bottom here. This is the total number of deaths that occurred, and this is for Denmark, Norway, and Finland. But this is the results for Sweden. And I think that this graph brings it home that certainly in the European and the Nordic experiment, herd immunity as a strategy was simply not successful. Now, for various reasons, this graph over here, this is the United States, is approaching that of Sweden, and there's some different factors. They had different parts of the country being differently affected. But based on where we are, it would seem that the strategy of mask wearing, wash your hands, and socially distance, let that play out, and that's certainly going to give us a leveling off and a victory over this COVID, whereas the herd immunity strategy, the prediction is something like 2 million deaths in the United States. So we're certainly advocating for doing the hand washing, the social distance, and most importantly, the mask wearing. Thanks to Kelly, and thank you for joining us today on Coping with COVID. I'm your host, Brian Mulligan. We'll see you again soon, so stay safe and stay healthy.